Very warm welcome. There are a few people away today. We'll pray for them later. And probably a disappointment for many that my nephew was going to come and talk to us about his mission to Mexico, SIM, that he's going to. But I'm afraid he's got COVID and his wife, so not able to do it. But he's got a little presentation that we're going to look at in a minute. But first of all, I thought it'd be really good as we're thinking about Mexico and what do we know about Mexico? Here's a little quiz, and I'll give you the answers at the end. I will say that the questions are very difficult, so if you don't get any right, I fully understand it. But here they are. So here's the Mexico quiz coming up. Well, maybe not. How many languages are spoken in Mexico? So, okay, right, that's the first one. I'll give you the answers at the end. Oh, yeah, that's the first one. Mexico City is the second largest city in the world. How many people live there?
8.798.
I mean, this is a bit mean because they're very close, aren't they? It's a lot of people, isn't it? Okay, third one. This is an interesting one. Taxi cabs in the world. Wow, that's a lot of taxi cabs, even if it's the lowest one. So, 142,000, 140,000, 152,000. Just think of that. Brighton has a population of about 300,000, so that's half of the population of Brighton and Hove all spread out there, and quite a big, the biggest city in Sussex. So, yeah. Okay. What is the population of Mexico? Here we go. Again.
That's a dense country, isn't it?
It is a dense country, yes.
But we've got 68 million people in this country.
Yeah, so there we are. A, B, or C. We'll get the answers at the end. Is there one more? I can't remember. Yes. Ah, and this is interesting because this is. They're paid daily. A lot of people just work each day. A bit like the Bible. They come along, they work the day and they get the wages, and that's very bad. And this is, so these, one of these is the right thing. So what's general minimum wage?
Well, I'd hope it would be $8.21.
Okay. And I think that's it, isn't it? Yeah. So think about that, but not too much when I'm preaching. So we're going to have our opening hymn. There is a hope that burns within my heart.
There is a hope that burns within my heart that gives me strength for every passing day. A glimpse of glory. A hope that lifts my weary head, a consolation strong against despair, that when the world has plunged me in its deepest pit, I find the Savior there. Through present sufferings,
Let's pray. That is a hope that burns within my heart. It'd be a wonderful thing, isn't it? Now, I know David and Maribel are unable to come today, but they've sent a little clip of what they're doing. So, Dave?
Good morning, Cheney Baptist Church. We hope that you're well. We are really sorry that we can't be with you, but we hope that this presentation will be a blessing to you. If you'd like to sign up to our newsletters, we have them. You can sign up via davidwjeaston@gmail.com. If you would like to support us financially, then you can go to the website sim.co.uk and type in David and Maribel Easton. And there you can donate as well in partnership with the mission. If the Lord has touched your heart today. Well, let's start the presentation.
Hi, I'm David, and this is Maribel, and this is Eliana, and Samuel is in the back playing with the lawnmower. We're hoping to go to Mexico in October this year, and we would like to invite you on the journey with us as we do so. We're just going to tell you a bit about ourselves. I'm from Croydon, and I was brought up here. And Maribel's from?
I am from Mexico, and I became a Christian when I was 17.
I became a Christian when I was 14 in Wales, and the Lord has been so good to both me and Maribel. We're going to an area called the Circle of Silence, which is in the central part of Mexico. And there's a little town called Arandas, and this is the place that we plan to start the ministry in. Within the Circle of Silence, there's only 1% or less who have the gospel. Mm-hmm. So the need is really great. The harvest is really plentiful, and the labourers are few. Mm-hmm. We plan to go there and to proclaim the word of God to people and train people and eventually to plant churches within the Circle of Silence.
It all started back in 2013 when we went to visit my family in Mexico, and David could see that people in churches, ministers, were not trained very well, and so his burden for training people in Mexico grew more and more.
We ran a conference that came into fruition, and many young people came. And this really put a burden on my heart for Mexico. And so I prayed to the Lord to seek guidance and also to seek his word of whether we should go to Mexico. We did training at Cornhill. Maribel did the training for 2 years. I did the extra year. And there we were able to really get to grips with the word of God to be able to be better teachers of God's word.
In Mexico, we want to be involved in training people for ministry so that they can better teach the Bible and understand the Bible as well. Hopefully, we're going to be doing some church planting, discipling, just preaching the gospel to everyone who needs it. We really appreciate if you could support us in prayer. That's the most important thing for us. But if you feel led to partner with us, just go to the SIM UK website.
We believe that nobody should live or die without the gospel of Jesus Christ.
There's much more of it, but I mean, if you want to see the fuller video, then please come and see me and we can arrange that. But that's just what they're doing, which is a big operation, isn't it? And we need to pray for them. So we'll just put some little prayer requests up and we'll have a word of prayer just for David, Mirabel and Mirabel and the children. So here are the points, really. Now, one thing he mentions in the big video is that the prosperity gospel is rife in that country. I don't know if you know what the prosperity gospel is. Yeah, and you know, the preaching that if you do this, this and this and give to us, then you will be rich also, which is another gospel, which is very prevalent to what we're going to speak about in Galatians. So we need to pray against that. It's very prevalent amongst that. And also alongside that, the Catholic Church is very strong, and the Catholicism is different to this country. It's very dark in places. So we need to pray that the gospel may be preached. For safety, because kidnapping is common. There is police corruption and the drug-related crimes. I think we all know that from reading the news or listening to the news. They're serving it, as it was mentioned, in an area called as the Circle of Silence, where only 1% have heard the gospel. 1% have only heard the gospel. I mean, that's pretty awful, isn't it? So we pray for that. And pray that they may build relationships with people. That's very important, isn't it? Just to come in there, build relationships for the time. Pray for good working relations with other SIM workers. They're going to partner up with some others that are already there. For clear teaching for David as he tutors pastors. For David learning Spanish better. Obviously, his wife doesn't need to do that, and the children are pretty good as well. The children adapt to their new surrounding. That's difficult, isn't it? They've been born in this country. They've only known this country. It's going to be a real culture shock for them when they go out there. For vaccinations, that's always something we pray for missionaries when they go out there, the mini vaccinations. David gets his visa and the children their registration. He hasn't got his visas through yet, and I think it's October they're going. So he's getting close now. So, and then planning meetings that they'll need to do. I pray that God will be over that. And the support partners will be raised, prayer and financial, because obviously they need money to go, but they also really, really require us to pray for them. And then for David and Mirabel's newsletter to go, you go to davidjweaston@gmail.com. I've got a little card here if you want to, and have a look at their newsletter. And you can have that every month. So let's just have a word of prayer. And it's an open word of prayer, just praying for these points, just briefly. I'll start. Lord, we preach against the prosperity gospel in anywhere in the world, but particularly we're thinking of Mexico, and we think of the evils that it causes people. Particularly in Mexico, where we have already learnt they don't get much money, but they're really prying on them. So we pray against that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, we pray for safety for David and Mirabel and the family. It must be quite a little bit scary if you're thinking about the corruption and things that happen in the country that could make you fearful. Lord, help us all, particularly them, to lean on you, Lord. And to just give all our fears to you, Lord. Because you are ultimately powerful, ultimately strong, ultimately caring and loving, Lord. And just pray for your protection for this family. But pray, Lord, just pray that they will be able to just depend completely on you and not be filled with fear that may hold them back from doing things, Lord, that you want them to do. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for the relationships that they want to build up, Lord, both outgoing and friendly people, Lord. So we just pray that they will be able to come amongst the people there. Really make some friends and really be able to speak the gospel to them, Lord. And also we think of the relationships they're leaving behind, Lord, both mum and dad have cancer, Lord, and it's really difficult for them as well to be not seeing their grandchildren. Or, so we just pray for that, Lord, that there'll be good times, maybe over Zoom or whatever technology, Lord, and we just pray for them as it will be arranged for both sides. To ask in your name.
Amen.
Amen.
Dear Lord, I do pray for their good working relationship with the SIM workers that are already there, particularly one couple they're going to partner with, hopefully. Pray that they may have this unity of the Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
May God pray for help with getting visas and all the bureaucracy. I'm sure there's going to be a lot more forms and things, and pray that will happen in time, in your time. Amen.
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 Dear Lord, we do pray for the vaccinations and all those will be done without any ill effect. Amen.
Amen.
Dear Lord, I thank you for your sorting out the problems with me and Ken, Lord. I've left Ken now, I'm going out with John and I'm very happy. Amen.
Amen. Dear Lord, we do pray for the circle of silence, as it's called, and obviously it's a hard ground, but also a fertile ground to preach the gospel. And for a lot of people, it would be the first time they've really heard the good news about the Lord Jesus Christ. Pray that this may be indeed a fruitful area, but protect them from those that will rise against them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for this family's willingness to leave everything in their here and to go and to work in such a difficult area of the world, Lord. I pray that you will actually help us to go out from our nice homes into our nice little village and share with Jesus about here and change. And for us not to be fearful, we don't have to be frightened of being kidnapped or police corruption or anything, Lord. We just live in such a safe country in comparison. Lord, that you will give us a real heart for you, and that you will set our hearts afire for you, Lord, that we will want to speak about you to everybody in need. Help us to share our faith, and share our joy in you with everybody we meet here in Chile, as we pray for that for David Miller in Mexico. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Dear Lord, we also pray for David learning Spanish. Languages isn't his forte, so we do pray that you'll overcome that, and that you'll give him strength to learn Spanish well. He's had a good tutor and his wife, but Lord, there's nothing like being in the country to learn the language. So pray for him, help him in his studies. Amen.
Amen. I do pray that David and Maribel have patience for the long haul.
Yeah.
Because we pray that they'll be fruitful, but we realise that sort of work takes many years to reach fruition. And we're going to look today at Paul, and he went up to Jerusalem 15 years after the beginning of his ministry, and he had yet to see great fruit. And so we realise that it's not an instant thing to start up a new work, and it can be hard and difficult, and we do pray that they have patience and they rely on you and realise that it's a long-term commitment. I mean, it doesn't mean that you don't want to support them, but they have to put down those roots and to make those links. And so we do pray that they might be in it for the long term, and that they might realise that and continue to have faith in you and to walk close with you. Amen.
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 So, dear Lord, we thank you for this time of prayer, and I pray for David and Maribel and the family, and all the things we pray for, and maybe the things we pray for silently, that you would bring them all up to you, Lord, and leave them at your feet. We thank you we can come with the small things and the large things. You're a great and marvellous God, and that you're capable of listening and also hearing all our prayers. Thank you for this opportunity of coming to you to pray, for prayer and in prayer. Lord, we thank you that we can come through the precious blood of Jesus, and that we can come boldly to the throne of grace. We thank you, and we bring all these prayers before you now and leave them at your feet. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Going to have a second hymn. We're looking for a sort of mission hymn, and we found this one, Facing a Task Unfinished. It's the Getty's version of it. It's a beautiful rendition of it.
To labor for thy sake, we go.
Jesus Christ the Lord, praise his name. Got a few notices here for this week. Messy church on tomorrow at 4:30. Our subject is Jesus Goes to Heaven. And our prayer is that, obviously you pray for us at this time when we're having this messy church meeting. But when we had a Sussex Day event up at the green up there, there were several people that said they might come along, so that'd be good if they would come along and boost their numbers. So we normally get about 30-odd. Let's pray for 50, 60 this time. Yeah, let's be ambitious. Okay, they'll pray for all the helpers and everyone who comes along. They'll have a messy time, but a good time learning about the gospel as well. And pray for me as I give the message. On Wednesday, we have a prayer meeting here, as usual, from 11:30 to 12:30. It is an open prayer meeting. Come in for 5 minutes, if you like. It's there, the church is open, and that's please do come along if you're able to. And then the home group is at Brenda Barnes at 7:30, and the questions at the back there on the cupboard, so please take one if you're coming along there. 7:30, we're going to look at a few of the issues we're thinking about this morning as we go through Galatians. Next week, we have our good friend Gordon Hamilton coming, and he's preaching from following on from what I am doing, Galatians 2, 11 to 21, so pray that he will have a really good message for us. It's always very entertaining to have Gordon with his guitar and the things that he says. It's very good. And then a future event, on the 23rd, we have Prom Praise here, supper from 5 p.m. They had a big Prom Praise in Royal Albert Hall, which Jan and I went to, and my sister and brother-in-law, who are over from America. We enjoyed it so much that we're bringing it here for the on the 23rd at 5 p.m. We're going to have a supper as well. Fish and chips, I believe. It'll be good. Next week, I think we're going to have a little piece of paper, so if you want to come, you can put your name, and we know how many to cater for. But it's a really good occasion. It was superb. It was 3 hours long, but I'm not sure if we're going to have all of it, but there we go. It was very good. So that's really worth putting in your diaries. So just going to have a short time of prayer, which I will mention these items. And then also we think of Jeanette and Peter. Peter's not well. And so we pray for them. I pray for Anne, who's not here, and others that are not here, and pray for their well-being. Dear Lord, we thank you that we can come, as I said, and pray about many things, big and small. Do pray for this week. We pray for Messy Church, and pray that it may go well, that it will go safely as we have our barbecue, and Lord, that you'll give me the right words to speak to a noisy audience, but an appreciative audience, hopefully, in this church tomorrow. Pray for the prayer meeting on Wednesday. I pray that we may come together and worship you and ask for anything, as I say. And it's a really good time, an hour with you in prayer at this church. So pray for that. And then the home group in the evening at Brenda's. Thank you for Brenda opening our home for us, that we may have a fruitful time looking into what maybe these questions that have been asked this morning, and maybe we answer them a little bit better. And Lord, I pray with us there, and thank you for that meetings and the meetings and all that we get out, the fellowship and everything. Pray for everyone who comes along, and pray that we may have a good time then. Pray particularly for Gordon Hamilton as he comes next week, and thank you for his ministry, and pray that we may prepare our own hearts and minds for his word. And then looking forward, Lord, we pray for the 23rd Prom Praise Supper. It's good to praise your name, and it's good that we can relive those times we've had with the thousands at the Royal Albert Hall in our little church here. Pray that we may have a good time and a great evening singing along to the hymns that we can and listen to those that we can't. And Lord, we do pray for those that aren't here today. Pray for Richard and his carers. We don't know why they're not here. We pray for Anne, Lord, and again we pray that she's well. And we pray for Pete and Jeanette, and Pete's got a chest ailment. Pray that they may get well soon. And Lord, for any others that are not here, and maybe for any reasons, that you'll be with them and bless them. Thank you for seeing briefly David Mazzell as he came. And pray for him and Maureen. And thank you for their ministry that from afar that they've had to do because of his immunity problems. And Lord, thank you again for his encouragements for the church. We'll pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing our next hymn. And after this, Janet is going to come and read from Galatians 2, 1 to 10. So my hope is built on nothing less.
So we're going to be reading Galatians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. Then, after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem, this time with Barnabas. I took Titus along also. I went in response to a revelation, and meeting privately with those esteemed as leaders, I presented to them the gospel that I preached among the Gentiles. I wanted to be sure I was not running and had not been running my race in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised, even though he was a Greek. This matter arose because some false believers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us slaves. We did not give in to them for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. As for those who were held in high esteem, whatever they were makes no difference to me. God does not show favoritism. They added nothing to my message. On the contrary, they recognized that I had been entrusted with the task of preaching the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been to the circumcised. For God, who was at work in Peter as an apostle to the circumcised, was also at work in me as an apostle to the Gentiles. James, Cephas, and John, those esteemed as pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. All they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I had been eager to do all along. Amen.
Thank you, Janet. Please do keep that passage open as we continue through Galatians. So, I don't know what you were thinking when this was read. What was your first thoughts? To be honest, was you indifferent? Was it very ordinary? Was it boring? Well, our reaction should be, or should have been, fear and gratitude. It takes us to a meeting in Jerusalem about 45 AD. Which may seem distant from the concerns of the 21st century Christians. What's it going to do with us now? But in fact, the stakes could not have been higher. This is a new church. There were a lot of passions running. There were a lot of ideas. It was a meeting that had huge consequences for us all now, even today. And as we will see, God protected all of us. You and me to this very day, by what happened there. It could have gone so wrong. So we're going to look briefly at 4 points. First, we're going to look at Paul's fear, the stakes that were on the stakes of what was going to happen there, what could possibly have happened there, the verdict of what happened, and then the outcome of the carrying on from there. So firstly, let's look at Paul's fear. But just before that, as an aside, in verse 1 it says, 14 years later I went up again to Jerusalem. That sometimes is overlooked as we read this chapter. 14 years from when he had been converted on the road to Damascus. What had he been doing in those 14 years? He'd been preparing for ministry. And we were told in the first chapter that this preparation period included a time alone with God. In fact, a large time alone in God. In verses 16 and 17 of chapter 1. As well as a time confirming with other Christians, often new Christians. And in their zeal, they want to begin their ministry straight away. It's something that they do, isn't it? They go to college, they believe, they go to college, and then they feel they must go straight into a job. That's not what Paul did. He had the learning, he had the understanding, but he wanted to find out what it was like to live among people. If you think of those 14 years he lived in Arabia, where he studied the Word of God, what was he doing in that time? What was he doing for money? He didn't have any money. He was working as a tent maker, as we found before. He was working with the people. He was finding out what it was like to work, as it were, on the coalface. After 14 years of preparation, he then felt he was able to go to the Jerusalem church, and then they sent him out on the missionary journeys. So sometimes we have to think that people are in a hurry to go into the missionary work when they haven't had the grounding of working in their situation. So it's just in a thought. But so what was Paul's fear, coming to what I was saying? His fear was that he's running his race in vain, verse 2. He felt, am I doing all this in vain? Is it for nothing? I went to respond to the revelation set before them, the gospel that I preached among the Gentiles. He started his message among the Gentiles, but there was something going on. There was something going on that was giving him trouble, that was troubling him. So what was this? What was his fear? Well, verse 3 will give us a clue. But I did this privately to those who seemed to be leaders, for fear that I was running or had run my race in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised, even though he was Greek. So we could assume here, and we can be implied from these words, that nothing was threatening Paul's certainty about what he was doing, but something was threatening his fruitfulness. Equally, Paul's trip was not for fear that the Jerusalem apostles didn't have that true gospel, but that they would not be true to that gospel. That was his fear. They might not stand up to the false teachers. The problem is the false teachers have come in and said, you must do this. Yes, it's good. It is good that you become Christians, but you've got to do other things. So that was his fear. So what was at stake here? What was the second point is, what was at stake here? Simply and fundamentally, church unity. There had to be one gospel. There had to be unity within this church. It couldn't be splitting off here, there and everywhere. I thought of it a bit like a boxing match. We have in the red corner, we have Paul and the gospel of faith. And he's punching away for that. And the gospel of faith is that you must believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Saviour. And that's the principle of the gospel, the good news about the Lord Jesus Christ. And then in the blue corner, the false teachers, there they are, they're coming out. And they were saying, yes, not all Jewish people are Christians. There's a chance for Gentiles, but there's always a but, isn't there? But all the Christians must become Jewish. It's bizarre, isn't it? So you can become a Christian, but you've got to go through with all the rituals of being a Jew. Circumcision and all sorts of things, and the eating of meats and eating of other things that you can't do as a Jew. John Stott, a very wise man, wrote this about this. It was one thing for the Jerusalem leaders to give their approval of a conversion of the Jews, but could they approve of commitment to the Messiah without inclusion in Judaism? Was their vision big enough to see the gospel of Jesus Christ not as a reform movement within Judaism, but as good news for the whole world, everyone, and the Church of Christ as the international family of God? And that's what we are, the international family of God. So it was a massive stake that he had here. If they had decided that no, they must be circumcised, no, they must do all this, it would have mean a split of the church, wouldn't it? That's why Paul said that the freedom we have in Jesus in verse 4 was under threat, and therefore the very truth of the gospel was at stake. Freedom in Christ. Verse 5 says this. We did not give in to them for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might remain with you. Didn't give in to these teachers because they saw the freedom of the gospel was important for them. And as I said, it could have been so different. It could have split the church in two. Those who were saying, yeah, you've got to do that. And those that saying, no, I understand what you're saying, Paul. It's a new covenant with God, a covenant through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the way that we go forward. You don't have to do these rituals that were a foreshadow of Jesus. Of course you don't. And it could have gone the wrong way. So no wonder Paul felt fear, that the stakes could not have been higher, could they? So here he presents his case to the church at Jerusalem. The church at Jerusalem were obviously the leaders, the apostles that were all there. Because we read in Acts that most of the other Christians have been driven out by Paul. You know, this is amazing. God has got a sense of humour. Paul drove out all those Christians so they could go into all the other lands and preach the gospel. Win-win situation, isn't it? But the apostles stayed in Jerusalem, protected by God, and they were still there. So he went back to that church, the apostles, those who had been with Jesus, those who had had the foundations of the church. It could have ended so differently. So the stakes were amazingly high. So what was the verdict of the church at Jerusalem? Simply saying, it was welcome, Paul. Welcome to your ministry. Yes, we agree with you. In verses 6 and 7, it says this. For all those who seemed to be important, whether they would make no difference to me, God does not judge by eternal, external experience. Those men added nothing to my message. They didn't say I needed to add anything. On the contrary, they saw that I had been trusted with the task of preaching the gospel to the Gentiles, just as Peter had been to the Jews. The gospel is a very simple thing, but it is also very profound. The gospel is very simple, and it's simply this, that you need to yield your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to surrender everything to him. You need to trust in him, that he died on the cross, that he rose again, and he is living now in heaven, ascended up. We're going to talk about that tomorrow in Messy Church. But that's the simpleness of the gospel, that we're apart from God because of our sin, and there's nothing that we can do that we can merit salvation. But if we come to the Lord Jesus Christ, who's done it all for us on the cross, and he has died in our place, an innocent person for those that are convicted by sin, because God cannot look on sin, we can now have that passage. I love that illustration. There's God, there's us, and there's the cross that has given us. And that's the gospel, and it's very simple. But it's also very profound, because it says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me, Jesus said. It's the only way you can be saved. You can't work your way to salvation. And the church at Jerusalem showed that they accepted that because of Titus. They accepted Titus. He was a Greek. That's the important thing. Sometimes we read the Bible and we miss some of the points. Titus came and he was a Greek, and he's coming into a very Jewish situation. He's coming into people that have been used to being with Jews all their life. And yet they welcomed him. Said he didn't say, you can't come in because he's a Greek. He's not circumcised. They had accepted Paul's ministry and these radical implications of the gospel. It was very radical. It was very, very radical for the Jewish nation. It's radical for everyone today, because everyone wants to rule their own life, don't they? They want to be able to say, I am in charge. And Jesus is coming and saying, you're not. You need to yield to me. You either become a slave of sin and the things of this world, or you become with me. Don't enslave them. Paul was saying, don't enslave them in all these regulations. It's a credible welcome, wasn't it? Regulations of cleanliness and laws of Moses. Do you imagine what that was like for those outside of Judaism? And here they come with this message of Jesus Christ. They accept him willingly, and they look to him, and they become saved, the Holy Spirit works within them, and then they turn around and said, oh, by the way, you've got to be circumcised. Oh, you can't eat this meat, you can't do that, you can't do this, you can't do that. how discouraging and how wrong it was. But actually, are we a bit like that? Do we say, I know some churches would frown if somebody came in shorts, David, but we don't. Or somebody came not actually wearing a tie. Or in my mum and dad's church, bless them, it was a lovely church, but you had to, if you're a woman, you had to wear a hat. There was all sorts of things like that, all those regulations. And the regulations about the Sabbath and what you do on Sunday. And I'm not decrying all these people, but they were very, very strict about what they did. They added to the gospel, I'm afraid. They added to what we need to do. And they frowned on people that didn't do it. And we can do that in very small ways or large ways. So we need to be careful and ask God that we don't do that. We don't put obstacles in the way of people coming to Christ. We know it's impossible to make ourselves perfect, acceptable for holy God. But we have someone who does that for us, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I said this before, and this is an amazing thing. If, as a Christian, if we've committed our lives to the Lord Jesus Christ, when we live our lives, when God sees us, he only sees his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, we need to come and ask for forgiveness for the sins that we do. But God only sees us in Jesus. And that's real freedom, isn't it? That's real freedom. Not freedom to do wrong, of course not. Because the Spirit lives within you. And Paul goes on to say, if you're doing wrong, then you've got to actually doubt that you are a Christian. Because of that work within you, within the Holy Spirit telling you it's wrong. And I think it's true in my case. Just a small thing here, that I was brought up in a Christian home. So the difference between me becoming a Christian and not being a Christian was slight. But the difference is the guilt that was within me when I did something wrong. That conscience was quickened by the Holy Spirit. That conscience was there. And I was safe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I came back to him. But these false brothers had used their regulations in order to teach the exact opposite. No freedom. That we could make ourselves pure. That we could make ourselves more acceptable to God for the things we do. That's not possible. It's not possible. And we could do that through strict compliance with these things. And it was a thing that wasn't just happening in the Galatians church. There's a thing chapter 3, which I'm actually preaching on. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? I love that verse. But it's, you know, it's true. It could be about anyone. You foolish people of Cheney, who has bewitched you? Because we get sidetracked into these things. And in the New Testament, many other times, other churches did that. The Corinthian church, they raised up people to great honour above others and look down on others. That's not what Christianity is about. There's all sorts of things going on in the churches that Paul had to reprimand them about. It was happening to churches and communities, and it happens today, and we need to be vigilant. So the acceptance of Titus by the Jewish believers was vivid illustration of this principle, that an individual becomes spiritually clean and acceptable through Christ, not through any deeds. We're going to have a communion service at the end of this week, and we have a celebration of why we do it, because we are now clean before him because of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're thanking him for that very act. We need to keep repeating this truth to ourselves and each other, just as the New Testament did. The New Testament churches. Gentiles, and I'm glad of this, could become full members of the people of God without becoming Jewish in custom or culture. And that's another thing about mission. Some missionaries make the mistake of going into a society and the culture's different, and they're trying to change the culture. That's wrong. The gospel's the important thing, but don't try and change the culture. I knew someone that was in a church planting in Nepal, and now when somebody dies in the Nepali family, you wear white as a symbol of respect. Now here's a missionary, somebody died, his father died, and he wore white. But to the church, they said, no, that's not right. He said, I'm being culturally pure for this situation. And how it can happen, and how you could offend people if you didn't, if you wore black. That wasn't how they did it. You've got to be aware of what the custom is. And as long as it doesn't go against what the gospel said, go along with it. Encourage him. Paul said about that, didn't he? Saying about eating meat sacrificed to idols. And some people were having a problem with it. And he said, if you've got a problem with it, don't do it. I like Paul. But he said, I haven't got a problem with it, so I'm going to continue to do it. And that's what we've got to do. We've got to be very conscious of each other and of other people around us. So the acceptance of Titus was a public statement of the implications of the gospel. So what was the outcome, finally? Well, I've hinted at it, haven't I? I've spoken about it. It's freedom, isn't it? In verse 4, it says this. This matter arose because some of the false brothers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Jesus Christ and to make us slaves. Paul, as he does often, puts the two sides of this argument in an illuminating way, doesn't he? He says the false brothers are here who infiltrated the Gentile churches, and he wants to make slaves again. They've been slaves to sin, and now he wants to make them slaves to the culture and the conditions of Judaism, preventing them from enjoying the freedom we have in Christ Jesus. The freedom they have in Christ Jesus, and we have great freedom in him. Paul is saying that the biblical gospel gives freedom while his opponents earn their salvation, and their messages that would lead people into slavery. Just think of it. If you had to do this, and this. I know that some organisation says if you knock on 200 doors, you've got a better chance of getting into heaven. Rubbish. It's between you and God. It's a personal relationship. And it's an incredibly different religion to anything in the world, because it's a personal relationship with a God. And that's not possible in many religions in the world. In fact, all the other religions, you can't have that personal relationship. And we can only have it through the Lord Jesus Christ, but we have great freedom in that. That's an incredible thing. Let's not impose laws of man on people and come into the gospel. We have that freedom. It is the main theme of this gospel, the freedom of the Lord Jesus Christ. Galatians had entangled the people. As I said, you foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? And we can do the same. But the question is, how does the gospel give us freedom? Verses 8 and 9 will give us some idea. A God who was at work in the ministry of Peter as an apostle to the Jews was also at work in the ministry of the apostles to the Gentiles. James, Peter and John, reputed to be pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship, and they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the Jews. So it was a unity of the church. Some people were doing something. Peter was going to the Jewish people, and Paul was going to the Gentiles. As I said before, God has got a good sense of humor, because Paul was the one that hated the Gentiles the most. And God said, okay, you do that. I'm sending you to the Gentiles. Just think of when he first became a Christian. Do you think he prayed, please, Lord, no, let me go to my people? Maybe he did, I don't know. But, you know, that was a real thing for him to do. The Pharisee of the Pharisees, the Jewish person you've ever known, and yet he was sent to the Gentiles. But what is this freedom? What is it? What can we have? Well, I think there's two things. There's a cultural freedom. We've touched on this. Dress code, food we can eat, rules and regulations. Timothy Keller, which I like a lot, has written on this point. He says, but rules and regulations like this get into the area of daily cultural life. If the false teachers had their way, an Italian or African could not become a Christian without becoming culturally Jewish. Christians would have to form a little cultural ghettos in every city. And it does happen. It would mean far too many emphasis on the external culture separation rather than on internal distinctiveness of the spirit, motives, outlook, and perspective, elevating cultural propriety to the level of spiritual virtue. Do you see what he's saying there? Leading Christians to a slavish emphasis on being culturally nice and proper, as well as promoting intolerance and prejudice attitudes. And that's so prevalent today, isn't it? I'm a good person, I'm a Christian because I do this, that and that. That's not what a Christian is. A Christian is someone who has devoted their life to the Lord Jesus Christ. These other things should come out of it, of course they should. But also the gospel leads us to emotional freedom. Anyone who believes that our relationship with God is based on keeping up moral behaviour is on the endless treadmill of guilt and insecurity. That's so true, isn't it? We've sinned, we've done something wrong, we hang our head. Good, in one way, but we don't follow it through and come to God and say, like the publican, God forgive me. A sinner. And it's done. Jesus said from that parable, the publican went home justified, never sinned. That's what it means. He became more justified than the Pharisee who said, I thank you, I am not like this scumbag over here. That's my own words. But you know what I mean? He's decrying all these other people. But he, the publican, understood it. He understood he'd sinned against God and he needed to ask forgiveness. And he got it. And if you rely on this first thing, you're on a total treadmill going, and you're only getting exhausted. The Gentile believers, from the moral implications of this, they would be in terrible trouble, wouldn't they? But I'm not saying that Paul didn't say that the Ten Commandments didn't matter. Of course they did. Christians shouldn't lie, they shouldn't steal, they shouldn't commit adultery, and so on. But though not free from the moral law, of course they do these things as a way to live, Christians are free from it as a system of salvation. That's the difference. Paul decries that he's still got this old man of sin in him. There's a battle going on. I know this is a cartoon, but you see it in cartoons, don't you? You see a devil on one shoulder and an angel on the other. And that's going on in our lives in a sense. The devil's whispering one thing, and God's and his word are whispering the other. But if it's relying on that for the system of salvation, we obey in fear and insecurity of hoping to earn salvation. But if in the freedom, security of the knowledge we have already saved, in Christ and in Christ alone, we obey in the freedom of gratitude. And that's the difference. And that's the huge difference. And that's the wonderful gospel message we have. It talked in here in that verse about we went in the grace of God. God's riches at Christ's expense. Easy to remember what grace means. And that's the nub of the gospel. That's what it's all about. I'm going to finish by nearly knocking over my water, but that hymn that we just sang, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less, is beautiful and so pertinent to what we're talking about. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. No merit of my own I claim, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. And on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When the last trumpet voice shall sound, may I then in him be found, clothed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before his throne. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. So in summing up, the false teachers and Paul told Christians to obey the Ten Commandments, but for totally different reasons and motives. And unless your motive for obeying God's law is the grace, gratitude motive of the gospel, you're in slavery. The gospel provides freedom culturally and emotionally. The other gospel destroys both. So let's hold on to this wonderful gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. As I said, grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. Gratitude commands us to do what? Many things. But verse 10 shows us one of the outcomes, the practical outcomes of this grace. All the church asked for of Paul was this. All they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, and the very thing that I was eager to do. So out of this grace and out of this wonderful love, the Lord Jesus Christ in their life, they flowed out to help others that are in need. That's an encouragement to us. Amen. Let us pray. Thank you. I thank you for this passage. I thank you that this meeting was very important, and yet it was a blessed meeting that helped us to have that freedom in Christ. Help us not to enslave our own lives in Christ. Help us to have this freedom because of the great gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Coming to our communion service now, and everyone who loves the Lord and is following him is very welcome to come to the table. We're going to come up in a minute and take the bread and the wine. But first, I just thought of a few things. I want you to turn, if you can, to Acts 1, verses 1 to 10. We're going to look at this passage tomorrow at Messy Church. But when I was looking at it, I thought it had a message for us as well. Acts 1, verses 1 to 10. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all the things that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. To know the times and dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going. Then suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside him. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into heaven? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Should have been verse 11.
Amen.
So, two questions. I want a quick question to ask. Are we working in the kingdom of God They were told to work in the kingdom of God. Are we willing to go out and proclaim the gospel as the apostles did? They still didn't understand what the gospel was about that time. But when the Holy Spirit came, it came evident to what that gospel was. It wasn't a restoration of the old things, of the Jewish nation, but it was about a spiritual nation. Are we working towards that? And the second thing is, as we look at this table, we do this until he comes, it says at the end of that. Are we waiting for his return? And in waiting, are we careful of what we do? Because the Bible warns us that when he comes, be in the right place in your mind and the things that you're doing. So are we working for him? That's important. And are we waiting for him? So let's come to the table. Paul, writing to the Corinthians, said this: "For I have received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Roger, I wonder if you'd give thanks for the bread.
Heavenly Father, we're thinking today about our Lord Jesus, how he came to earth at your commands, to make that link between us and you so that we could cross over and be in your presence. And we're going to take the emblem of the bread today to remind us that he physically came to earth and lived amongst us and died for us. And so we want to just thank you for sending your son, and we want to thank the Lord Jesus himself for loving us that much. And we want to thank you as we take this bread, that we can remember his sacrifice. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Please do come up and take the bread. Bread and wine, actually, together.
Why would we make some bread?
As we eat the bread, let us remember Jesus' body broken for us willingly and give him thanks. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Janet, can you thank us for the wine, please?
Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice on the cross, Lord, that you freely gave your body to be broken, to be killed. Your blood was shed, Lord. But that blood, we know, washes us clean. That blood washes us as white as snow and brings us back to our heavenly Father, Lord, unblemished, free, as a true child of God. Lord, we just thank you for that. Help us to remember it. Help us to be grateful. Help us to be changed by it. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. As we drink this cup, let us remember there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Praise God. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to sing our final hymn, which is When I Stand Before Your Throne.
Stand before your throne, dressed in glory not my own. What a joy I'll sing of on that day. No more tears or broken dreams, forgotten is the minor key. Everything as it was meant to be. And we will worship. Presence, we will sing. We will worship. Worship you. An endless hallelujah to the King. Forever in your presence, we will sing.
And to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy to the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.